Hello, I'm Captain Dan Kiggins from NASA's Langley Research Center in Virginia. Decisions, we make them all the time. And like driving a car, most of us feel we're pretty good at it. In this video, we'll discuss something called collaborative decision making with guests who I think you'll agree are experts. There's NASA's research test pilots Nils, Larson and Jim Less, the Cleveland Clinic's thoracic and cardiovascular surgeon, Dr. Michael Tong, and from NASA, Chad Stevens, a human factors researcher in the system-wide safety project. Nils, thank you for participating today. As NASA's research test pilot on the X-59 supersonic low boom demonstrator, you've undoubtedly made decisions in flight within the constraints of time, distance, and perhaps with even incomplete or conflicting information. Would you be willing to share an instance when this happened and the process you used to collaborate?
Thanks, Captain Dan. Flight test is kind of a weird animal because it kind of depends on what test you're doing. You can have more input than you'd ever hope to imagine. Think a control room with tons of people, or it can just be a flight with two test pilots that go out there. So the amount of information you have can be overwhelming, or it can be just like any other flight. One of the other things that you'll find is in flight test, we're pretty scripted. You know, for most of the time when we're doing the really dangerous stuff, if something is going to go wrong, you know, anybody can call the knock it off and we're just kind of coming home. So I'll give you a couple examples. Start out with one, and this was a large test, F-15 if you've ever seen it out there, and it was an intelligent flight control mission. So we have the control room down there, lots of different people monitoring my flight. And we're finished one of the maneuvers. I'm just in between points in 1G flight, and all of a sudden I get what we call the red phone, which means that is a direct line, not through the test conductor, but right directly from, in this case, the loads person. And I hear, knock it off, knock it off, knock it off, loads, which gives me a specific thing to go do, which basically I power down the whole system and get out. So I go through the procedures like I'm supposed to, and then I key the mic and ask them, how in the world can I have a knock it off for loads when I'm at 1G? So I got the dreaded call back that every test pilot hates to hear, stand by, as they discussed it in the control room and then said, we'll discuss it on the ground, go ahead and come back. It turns out that what happened in this case was the person on, you know, the loads happened to miss it during the actual point, but go back and he saw it, he called the knock it off, and then we came home. So in the end, it was a little conflicting guidance in that how could I over-G the airplane at 1G, but I just went through the normal procedures anyway. So that one is kind of an example with the tons of people that are there.
Well, thank you, sir. And Jim, thank you for participating today. As NASA's research test pilot on the X-59 supersonic low boom demonstrator, you've undoubtedly made decisions in flight within the constraints of time, distance, and perhaps with incomplete or even conflicting information. Would you be willing to share an instance when this happened and the process you used to collaborate?
So a few years back, we were down in Texas flying a supersonic test program off the coast of Galveston. We were flying F-18s and doing supersonic dives. So it was a questionable weather day. The scientists really wanted to get their data that day. But we knew that there were going to be thunderstorms in the area. And I'm out there in a single seat F-18 going through gas very quickly, using afterburner and trying to get these fairly challenging test points accomplished. And I don't really have a whole lot of capacity to look at the weather. But fortunately, we had a team on the ground. We had a control room there. In fact, one of the other pilots, Nils, was on the ground keeping an eye on the weather. So I was able to go out and pursue the test points, focusing on that, kind of keeping an eye for the building thunderstorms, and Nils is backing me up. So I get a call from the control room partway through that, yeah, the thunderstorms are moving in, I'm not gonna be able to get back to the field. We really don't have too many good divert options, and as I said, it's an F-18, and we're gonna be low on gas fairly quickly. So fortunately, Nils was able to come up with an alternate route home. We knocked off the testing when I got to a fuel state where that was required, and I made my way back a little bit of a circuitous route, but safely got the airplane back on the ground, and we were able to continue testing the next day and get everything that they wanted.
Well, thank you, sir. And now we turn to Dr. Michael Tong from the Cleveland Clinic. Dr. Tong is a thoracic and cardiovascular surgeon at the world-renowned Cleveland Clinic in Ohio. Dr. Tong, thank you for joining us. I'd like to ask if you'd share with us how you collaborate with your colleagues during surgery, and how you assimilate the input of your colleagues during surgery and the development of the surgical plan. Would you be willing to describe an instance where you chose to pivot mid-procedure and the process used to make that decision?
Thank you, Captain Kiggins. And yes, communication and collaboration is absolutely critical in order for us to be able to achieve the results that we can for our patients. And this starts with before we even get to the operating room. Over time, we have established a culture where everybody is empowered to speak up if they see something. At the beginning of an operation, we always do a safety huddle, and that's something that we borrow from the airline industry. This is a checklist with the patient awake. We go over the patient, their name, their date of birth, the operation that the patient is receiving that day, the equipment that we need, the tools that we're going to need, the medications that may be special, and also the allergies for the patient and anything that the team needs to be aware of so that we are all starting from the same page. And during any given operation in a cardiac surgery, we often have more than 10 members in the operating room, from the anesthesia team to the nursing team to the perfusion team, who runs the heart and lung machine to keep the patient alive while we are operating on the heart, and also from the surgical team. I have my surgical assistants as well as my residents and fellows. And it is this collaborative spirit and this open dialogue that we have through the operation that ensures that we can be fully aware of everything that's happening with this patient, not just on the heart that we're operating on, but from their overall physiology. During an operation and prior to an operation, we have a very clear plan of attack and how we're going to carry out the steps of this operation. This is something that I go over with my residents before every operation, and this is an opportunity for them to challenge me, to explain very clearly to them exactly why I'm doing the operation and in what order. About 6 months ago, we were doing a heart transplantation, and with every heart transplantation, sometimes the donor heart, when we put it in the recipient, can take a little bit of time for it to fully become vigorous again, particularly the right heart. The right heart often will struggle. It's usually not a big deal. It usually gets better after about 12 to 24 hours, but sometimes it can persist for a few days. And sometimes the right heart dysfunction can be so bad that it's just not able to pump enough blood to the body to meet the demands of our patient. And after we had implanted the heart really wasn't strong enough to deliver all the blood that the patient needed. Our anesthesiologist was escalating the amount of medications that he was giving to this patient. We were using some pretty strong doses of adrenaline and those type of medications to support the blood pressure. Our perfusionist was telling me they were monitoring the gases of the patient, and we could see that the patient was starting to get more acidotic. The lactic acid levels were starting to go up, and we were at a crossroad. Either we accept that this is going to be the best we can do for this moment and we just have to get over the next 24 hours, and usually by then the right heart was going to get better, or we decide to put a mechanical pump for this patient. It became very, very clear to me, and listening to everybody's input and telling me what they're seeing with regards to the patient, that this is not a sustainable situation that we can leave the patient for the next 24 hours. At that moment, we decided to put a mechanical pump, and as soon as I made the call that we're going to go ahead and put the mechanical pump, it was absolutely seamless. Our perfusionists knew exactly what to do. They got the pump ready within minutes. Our nursing team knew exactly the sequence of the sutures that we're going to need to implant the pump, and as well as our anesthesiologists. They knew exactly what medications that they need to give and make any adjustments necessary. Within the minutes, we had this patient fully supported. We were able to get the patient's chest closed. Ultimately, we got this pump out after about 2 days, and the patient did very, very well and went home after a couple of days. But this is just one example of where the constant communication and the collaborative effort of the entire team is how we can pivot when we have an unusual situation where we have a complication or we have a difficult situation, and still ensure that we can get the great outcomes for our patients.
Well, thank you, Dr. Tong. Of course, few of us are test pilots or renowned surgeons, but collaborative decision-making isn't an isolated skill reserved for the workplace. It's something we do nearly unconsciously at home and with friends where the lines of authority are less clear. I'd like to suggest these could be the most challenging circumstances in which to collaborate. So I've invited longtime NASA human factors researcher, Chad Stevens, who is also the father of two young boys, to share his perspective on collaborating outside the workplace. Coincidentally, Chad's spouse, Dr. Kelly Kennedy, is also a human factors expert with the U.S. Navy. With all this expertise, I'd like to ask if there is a transfer of skills developed at home to the workplace and vice versa.
That is an excellent question, Captain Kiggins. Work is part of our lives, and skills from home can certainly help us at work. Considering collaborative decision-making from a strictly human factors perspective, we make use of concepts such as situation awareness, workload management, stress, and distraction, among others, to understand and improve our decision-making. These challenges occur in work situations, as well as when interacting with our family and friends. In my life, my spouse and I are continually reminded by our children, Lucian and Cassius, who are preschoolers, that working together more often than not results in an outcome which is best for all. Our kids give us a fresh perspective, which challenges us to solve problems collaboratively. I recently learned of a consideration about parents and children, which is, as children, we may not realize we are watching our parents grow up. This helps remind me to see problems from their perspective. This speaks to the opportunity for intergenerational learning. That is just to say, as I can impart knowledge and hopefully a little wisdom to my kids, so too can they teach me, and we can grow together. NASA research and development in aviation and space exploration requires active collaboration. The NASA System-Wide Safety Project goals of developing and testing new technologies to enable future aviation systems is being conducted by teams with coordinated research efforts. I've learned skills from my research team members in system-wide safety, which helped me to solve problems at home. Working on human factors research with Kelly during her NASA research career helped us apply effective decision-making skills at home as well. Each experience in the flight deck, whether with a friend or someone new, presents an opportunity to apply training and experience by each member of the crew to achieve safe and efficient operations. This approach to decision-making is a practice of which we are all capable, and through practice, we can develop and refine to benefit our lives at work and home.
Thank you for watching.